here we are to have a little think about the practice of forming and running a band successfully. How do you do it? How do you go about it? What's the best way? Well, first of all, you have to find people, don't you? You have to find the personnel, and you can do that from your friends, or you can put an advert in the local paper or on Gumtree, for instance. That would be a way in the UK to actually find folk. Bass player required, must have own transport. Yeah, that's an important thing. If they can't get to the gig, doesn't matter how good they are, everybody's really got to have a set of wheels and not be reliant on Uncle Eddie taking them to the gig if he's free. So that's an important thing. Age wise, you should probably all be round about the same age, either, you know, old crocs like myself, or a bunch of young things, a mix. When it would work in the recording studio where nobody's seeing you, on stage it is going to look a little odd unless you incorporate it in the title, MacDonald and Sons, for instance. But yeah, you know, it's more like a furniture remover than a band, isn't it? Right, so you've decided to form a band. What sort of music do you like? Oh, you like heavy rock, do you? Alright. Do you look like a heavy rock musician? And when if you're going to be singing, do you sound like a heavy rock musician? Or, like myself, do you look like somebody's doctor and you have a voice that's actually quite gentle and folksy? Well, even if heavy rock was my first choice in music, I really couldn't carry it off. I've got the wrong equipment, and it's not that sort of equipment, it's what's actually in here. When I started singing in pubs many moons ago, that was roughly the situation that I found myself in. I had an acoustic guitar, I couldn't afford an electric, and my voice suited folk music. So, well, as I was going to earn money from this, that's the way I went. I wasn't doing it as a hobby or to make myself famous, I was doing it to pay the rent, which incidentally I did successfully until I retired a few months ago. Right, so go with what you're given, even if when you go home you listen to a totally different style of music. Now, relevance of the music. Who are you aiming at? What's your market? Are you aiming for the charts, in which case you've got to be contemporary and up to date and even possibly one step ahead of the game? And thereby hangs a little problem and a dilemma for all musicians. If you simply follow the trend, you'll never be the next big thing. You've got to try and get one step ahead of everyone else. And that's tricky, because odds are you're going to go in a direction that public taste is not going to go in. But if you don't try and be original, then you'll never be a great. You'll just be one of the many, one of the herd. Now, the relevance of music, there was a tale told way back in the late 60s, I think it was. It was a band called Sweet, and they were a kind of rock band back in those days, and they turned up one night to find the dance hall full of Rastafarians. Now, there's nothing wrong with Rastafarians in ones and twos and in dozens. There's absolutely nothing wrong with them at all, but The band members of Sweet quickly came to the conclusion that doing their normal repertoire was not going to go down particularly well. So what they did? Well, they just adapted everything. Everything went to a reggae beat. And apparently the gig was a roaring success. Great. I didn't have anything to do with that band. That's just a story that I heard. Okay, so be relevant. If you're in a Christian context, because running a band in a church is exactly the same as running it in a pub, except for the fact that people are probably not going to throw things at you. Yes, I've played in those sort of pubs. In a church situation, well, again, look at the ages of the people that are there. You know, are they my age? They probably don't want the latest Hillsong's twaddle. Oh, they don't write them like they used to. They probably want something from the Graham Kendrick era back in the 1980s and 90s. So be relevant to your audience, regardless of what sort of venue you're going to. Next subject, practice. How much do you need to practice? Well, there are several self-evident standards when it comes to practice. There's, can he play at all? There's, can play it badly? There's, can play it well at the right speed? And there's one more, because you'd think that would be enough, wouldn't you? But there's one more. Can play it well at the right speed without the music. Do you know it off by heart, in other words? Because if you can manage to get it learned off by heart, then it frees up everything else. You actually become a better performer on stage. Even if you're just the rhythm guitarist and you're not the centre of attention, you'll actually contribute more to the band if you know the stuff inside out. And you know it in more than one key. Right. Bands are full of normal human beings, and normal human beings occasionally get sick. Go on holiday. Have to go and see the teacher at school about wee Jimmy. So the band might not always be exactly the same format. You may not be the singer. Who's the second singer? If the main singer doesn't turn up, who's next in line? And do the songs suit the original key that you would have used for the main singer? Singer number two, do you have to raise the key or lower the key? What? So you might need to learn the songs in more than one key. One band that I was in, I was second in line for singing. But it was a girl who sang, and my voice was exactly an octave below her. And that was fine. Nobody had to relearn anything. But third in line was the bass player, and he was a tenor, so his voice was halfway between myself and the young lady. So we had to play everything in a different key when it was his turn to do the singing. Look, you know, the girl singer and myself were still a bit recovering from the flu, and it was this Kiwi chappy who would take over. Right, so that's your performance standard. How much material are you going to get through? Well, I used to do 2 hours in a pub, and if no one else came up to sing, if none of the customers wanted to come and sing, and it was just me for the whole 2 hours, that was approximately 40 songs. And if you're in the same pub night after night, well, you can't do the same 40 songs. So what I did, I had a repertoire of 120. And out of that 120, I would pick 40 for each night, just as the mood took me. And a nice way of practicing that lot is to write all the song titles on a wee bit of paper. Put them all in a big jar, a goldfish bowl would be ideal. And then just pick out every day, pick out half a dozen, and those are half dozen I'm going to practice. And you could even do the same at the gig if you wanted, but it could get a bit messy if you drop it all. Right, choosing your equipment. Think about your stage presentation, the sort of music you're aiming at. Now, can the music you're aiming at be played on an electric guitar? I found that if I played on an acoustic guitar, I was background music. If I played on an electric guitar, I was entertainment. Same songs, same style, played exactly the same way, but using an electric guitar, and everybody thought I was wonderful. Whereas, I've heard the same thing from keyboard players saying that if they play a piano, they're background music. If they play an organ, they're entertainment. Baffling, but human psychology dictates these things. Right, now what else have we got? Oh yes, your PA system and your amplification. Just what sort of power is required to do the job? Well, if you were actually just in a cafe, for instance, that would hold 50 people, then your wee practice amp that you use at home would probably do quite nicely. But if you've got a drummer, a live drummer, then immediately your wattage has to go up. A nice tame domesticated drummer, if there is such a thing, will produce about 50 watts worth of power from his kit. Animal, on the other hand, well, it could be 200 watts worth of oomph coming out that drum kit. It just depends on the individual. And you have to try and balance all that. Now let's say your drummer is a kind of average guy and he's producing equivalent of 100 watts worth of belt out of that kit. Well, that means the bass player needs a 100 watt amp, you the guitarist need a 100 watt, and second guitarist or keyboard player, again, it's 100 watts for everybody, just to keep level with that drummer. Now, the PA should actually be approximately as powerful as all the amps put together. So if you've got four 100 watt amps, then you should probably have a 400 watt PA system. It doesn't mean that you're going to be driving them all at full power. That would probably be a very bad idea. It's like running a car. If a car can do 110 miles an hour, well, that means it's happy at half of that. It's very happy at 55, but it's at 110, nothing's going to last terribly long. And it's the same with your PA systems. Microphones, there are basically two styles of mics. There's a kind of ball head one, which picks up everything in all directions. Well, actually more a kind of arc in front of you like that. And then there's the small-headed ones, which are more directional. They'll just pick up that and hopefully nothing else. So you've got to think, well, what am I like? Do I move a lot, move around a lot when I'm at the mic stand? Well, in that case, you want a ball-headed one, because you can kind of look that way and you can turn that way, and which is actually good for making eye contact with the audience. Making eye contact in a cafe setting, that's obviously quite easy to do. On a stage, well, if there's a big spotlight shining in your face, it's not really going to work, is it? If it's like a church situation, then yes. Now, in churches and folk clubs, it's more or less the same thing. It's just the lyrics themselves are different, but everything else is more or less the same. To get folk singing, if it's a situation where you want people to sing along, then what you do is, as you do your introduction, you pick someone, usually maybe three or four rows back, and you make eye contact with them, and as you're about to sing, there is a redeemer, you make eye contact and you do that, you give them the nod, and then I'm supposed to come in at that point. as I say, if there's a spotlight shone in your face, you probably can't see anybody. So you just imagine somebody out there and do it. But that's a useful thing. At the end of a song, do you want applause? Well, generally speaking, in church you don't. But in a folk club or in a rock venue, yes, you do want applause, because even if you think it doesn't much matter for yourself, the management of the place, if you want to get booked again, you want to get lots of applause. So a way at the end of the song to show the people that you are finished, you do something like this. And where's my hand? My hand's away from the guitar. It's not going back. They've heard the final chord. That's their cue to clap. Because I've seen an awful lot of acts who miss that. The song ends musically very well, but the audience aren't quite sure. Are the band finished? And they don't want to clap unless, and then, you know, be embarrassed by being the only one that claps. You know. So give them a good signal that the song is actually done. Right, now what else? Oh, the personnel in the band, obviously important. We've talked a wee bit about ages, but you have a decision to make about this band, probably right at the start. Are you a bunch of friends who have got together to make music, just for a laugh? Or are these other people your workmates, your colleagues? Is it a business that you're running? Right. Well, if it's a business, you can demand certain standards. They have to turn up on time. They have to be willing to practice until you get to that stage. Eventually, you'll get to a stage where you can do it in your sleep. You know, you don't really have to have regular practices. But until you get to that standard, you know, are they willing to actually commit to the time? And speaking of time, timekeeping is extremely important. How long does it take your drummer to set up? Well, that's if it takes him 15 minutes to set up, then he has to be there at least 20 minutes before the gig starts, preferably a wee bit earlier than that, because you'll have a sound check to do, and you can't really do a proper sound check if the drummer's still putting bits of his kit together. Now, if you get someone that can keep time, you have to make, again, a decision. Do you get rid of them, replace them with someone else, or do you try and find out why they're late and can you help in it? Like, maybe a family man, and he says, well, you know, I've got to get the kids fed and out, and I've got to walk the dog. Well, could you help by going over to his place before the gig and walking the dog for him? And take part of the load off the guy. You know, I know you don't hear pop stars doing it, but it's a good neighbourly, friendly thing to do if he's a good enough drummer that makes it worth the effort. If he's, you know, the sort of drummer that does a 4 in the bar and then a 5 in the bar fill. Yes, I've played with one of those. Oh, what you do is you when he starts his fill, you go 1, 2, 3, 4, stop, 1, 2, 3, 4, back in the song. You know. Mad, absolutely mad. Right, that's discipline. Etiquette in bands: do not run off with the girlfriends or wives or any of the other members. That's a no-no. Do not disappear at the interval at half time with that pretty girl that was in the second row giving you the eye. Can you kindly leave that till the end of the gig? Thank you very much. Drink. Oh, as it's known here locally, the bevy. Is that good for you or bad for you? From the musician's point of view, I'm not talking about what your doctor says about it, from the musical point of view, what is alcohol all about? Well, my experience was that anything over a half pint of beer, and I could tell that my fingers were actually slowing, and the audience wouldn't have noticed it, but I could tell I wasn't getting from quite as quickly as I would have liked. So I took a tip from my father, who was basically did the same things that I'm doing. He said, at the start of the evening, buy yourself a pint of beer, drink half of it, and leave it in plain sight on a table on top of the amp or whatever we're looking at here. And that means that when people come up and say, can I buy you a drink, son? You're great. You can say, oh, no, I'm okay. Thanks for the thought, but I've got one. That's the best thing to do with it, really. Otherwise, by the end of the evening, you could be absolutely legless. And if you've got to drive home, well, you can. Yeah, you know. In fact, nowadays in Scotland, you're not allowed to drink at all and drive, which is quite a good idea. Right, keep your drinking till after the gig. When you're on back home, you want to get plastered, or you want to pack up the gear and then go to a different pub or whatever. But this brings us to the point of security. There are people out there who will pinch your strat. I know it's hard, it's a terrible world, but they will quite happily break your heart and pinch your Stratocaster and your amp and your mics and everything else. So if you're going to leave the van, you really need to leave someone in it to protect it. Awkward, yes, but really, you're just asking for trouble if you don't. When I worked in music stores, about once a month, I would have somebody coming in and saying, our van got broken into. And actually, quite a lot of them were also got musicians from churches. Similar frequency, about once a month, because yeah, in church we use the same gear that everybody else uses. We're not, you know, we're not all playing 200-year-old instruments. We're quite up to date. And the thing about churches is you cannot assume that everyone that's in that building is a Christian. In fact, you wouldn't really want that if you were in a church, because you want people that are known Christians to come in so that they hear the message and become Christians. Aye, that's the idea. So that means that there are going to be people in there that are not Christians. Now, some of those people will be honest as the day is long. Others will be rascals looking for a Telecaster or whatever. And I used to get a regular supply of Christian musicians coming in and asking for insurance quotes. Can I quote for the insurance? My guitar got nicked from church. Yes, and I've actually been in a church where people's handbags were getting nicked by a lady that kept changing her seat in the congregation. She got caught, but yeah, that happens. So be careful. Be suspicious of everyone, really. And speaking of being suspicious, if you're playing in public, you, if you're any good, you will get these offers. Son, I can make you a star. You can come on my cruise ship and all sorts of things. You can join. Have you ever thought of doing an a cappella barbershop quartet? You get all these daft ideas. You get loonies who just are trying to impress the girlfriend. One character had an ex-Miss Scotland on his elbow, and I was just showing off in front of her, making big promises that he couldn't. Eventually called his bluff, but there was nothing there. So beware of that. Don't get your hopes up. Okay, that was drink. That was people that make you promises. Oh, drugs. Nah. Just. Nah. Forget it. If you're on drugs, you may be thinking that you're playing a blinder up here. You know, oh wow. And everybody out there is thinking, that guy's stoned at his skull, he's playing rubbish. happens. I've seen it happen. Some of the big bands who go into the studio and are, you know, oh, their heads are away. They're away full of mints. They do their recording session, and most of it, apart from the vocals, most of it goes in the bin. And then old fuddy-duddies like me come along and do their own music. So what you're actually hearing on that classic album from 1976, no, it wasn't them playing, it was an old guy like me playing. Yeah. Because they were too stoned to know. There could be a clue to one of the bands there. Anyway, moving along. Right, your appearance, dress. And I don't mean you have to wear a dress. I mean, you know, how are you going to dress? A wee bit of uniformity is required. If you're going to be a kind of heavy rock, death metal band or something like that, well, you know, you'll have the appearance. You'll have the leather jackets and the chains and all that stuff. Well, fine. But you don't want a guy with a leather jacket and the chains, another one in a suit, and a girl wearing an evening dress. It's not going to work visually, is it? No, you have to kind of follow a theme through everybody's in shirt and tie, or everybody's looks like hippies, or everybody, whatever. Yeah. You want to try and do that. Not necessarily have to turn up the same way at every gig. You could have multiple personalities. It's a flower power themed evening, whatever you fancy. The easy option is when if you're not sure, is you phone up and you can just say, right, we're all wearing blue, you know, we're wearing a blue tops. The thing about that is there's lots of different shades of blue. How do you get around that? Well, why don't you make it black? We're all wearing black tonight, because, well, black is black, more or less. There's not the amount of variation in black clothing that there is anyone else. And that's why a lot of bands that you see actually do appear in black. But if the gig has a black curtain behind you and you're wearing black, then you look at a lot of disembodied heads floating about the stage. That's not terribly good. So yeah, try and find out what the backdrop is going to be if you're fussy about your appearance and how you look. Modesty. There's a word you don't hear much in the 21st century, but modestly. Should your female members dress modestly, or should it be, if they've got it, flaunt it? Well, you'll certainly get more YouTube hits if they flaunt it. That's very true. But sometimes with beauty, more is less, less is more. I remember watching a TV show once, Top of the Pops it was called, and there was this girl on who was basically wearing a webbing from neck to ankles. It was a webbing, and it covered the essential bits, but there was an awful lot of bare flesh showing. And the next girl on had jeans, white t-shirt, white cardigan. Yes, which one was better looking? Well, actually the second one. There's a band called Sixpence None the Richer, I remember. Beautiful looking girl, very modestly dressed. Even a Muslim couldn't really have complained. And yeah, she was 10 times looking better than the thing that was on 5 minutes earlier. Now, I'm not against looking at a bit of female form. I'm a human being after all. But yes, you have to think about that, you know. And there's a whole women's lib issue comes into that. Yes, they should be free to wear whatever they want, but are they just wearing something skimpy because men have told them that that's what they should do? Or is that a message that they have absorbed subconsciously? Yeah, big issues there, big issues. So you try and again make it suitable for the audience that you're at. If you think there's going to be a fight, then you don't want the lassie there in high heels. You want them in a pair of trainers so she can run for her life with the rest of you. Now, speaking about fights, what happens if a fight breaks? out. And yes, I have been in that situation. Well, I think the best thing to do is to keep playing. Because if you stop, you're liable to get dragged into it by one side or the other. If you keep doing what you're being paid to do, you're less likely to get involved. And the head of a guitar, even if it's not a pointy thing, even that stuck in somebody's ribs, is quite a good deterrent to keep them, get off my stage. And if worst comes to the worst, well, you can always use it as a club, battle them over the head with it, you know. Hit somebody with a Les Paul, they might never get up again. Assess a fight. When you go into a pub, have a look at where the exits are and think, if trouble starts, how do we get out of here? Or do we want to get out of here? One situation, a fight had started after very quickly the bouncers sorted it out and chucked the offending dozen folk out into the car park. And then one of the band members said, should we leave? And I said, well, no, because the fight is now out in the car park. We're actually safer staying here and finishing the gig. They didn't ask us back the next night, but they said, oh, I said, we're busy here. Right, sound check, I mentioned that earlier. It's quite important to have a very brief sound check. You don't need to do your whole repertoire, just do one song, let the guy up the back tweak the knobs, whoever's doing it, and make sure everything actually is working. Going with guitar leads and things like that, always take one more than you think you're going to need, because guitar leads, like light bulbs, can just let you down at the last minute. Are you the type that breaks strings very easily? Well, then take a spare guitar. Or play a 12 string, and it just doesn't matter, does it? You'll have plenty left. Right, now you're on stage and about to start. If you're working from sheet music, have you worked out what you're going to do with it when you're finished with that particular song? Is it in a folder where you just turn the page? Which is fine if you're doing them in the order that they appear in the folder, but if you're jumping all over the place, you don't want to be going through, you know, your folder looking for that song. You want to be able to do it pretty quickly, so get the songs in the order that you want. Get them on your presumably your music stand, and when you're done with it, either put it on top of your amp or just put it on the floor. And if all else fails, just drop it on the floor so it's out the road and tidy it all up at the end of the gig. One mistake I did make was I once wrote out my song list. Now what I would usually do with a song list is I would just write the first few words, first three or four words of each song, and the opening chord. It was in G or it was in A minor, whatever it was. But this night I wrote it in a red pen, which seemed all right, until they shone a red spotlight on me at the gig. And then the page, it just disappeared. I mean, I was looking at a blank piece of paper. You know, I just couldn't read a thing. It had gone because of this red spotlight. Been stuck with just looking at a pink sheet of paper. So black pen. You do it in black pen. Now, we're nearly there. Signals to the band while you're playing. Now, if you normally do your songs just the same way every evening, it's going to be three choruses, three verses, an instrumental. That's it. Right, then fine. You don't really need band signals. But if you're in one of those situations where the leader of the band is kind of reading the audience, I think they're loving this, let's do it again, then there are various signals that you want to go for right now. So if I want you to do the chorus again, there you go, letter C, we're doing the chorus. If I want you to do the verse, it's that. I'm not being rude, it's not, or give peace a chance, but that's it for the verse. If the song has a bridge, that kind of middle 8 bit in it, and you want to go there, Now this threw me completely the first time I saw this sign. It's what's that? I thought, has she seen a squirrel up the back of the hall or something? Which is, you know what I mean? But no, that's it. You're going over the bridge. You're going over the bridge. If you want more power, more volume, let's pump it up. And if obviously if you wanted to, calm down. Like that. And the last one is if we're just going to do the whole thing again. That's it, we're just doing the whole thing all over again. That's a sort of style that applies more to maybe the kind of charismatic churches than it does to secular bands in a pub. Other signals, if you're busking along with a bunch of guys that you know, or girls, that are using material that you're not familiar with, then if you get this, or that, and that doesn't, this time it doesn't mean the verse, that's two sharps, one flat, three sharps. So you've got to know your key signatures, three sharps, key of A, two sharps, key of D, one sharp, S, you're right, G, and so on. And the flat keys, of course, as well. So I had that thrown at me once. It was the third song before I twigged what was actually what these signals actually meant. And there's another point. If you're going to use signals, explain them before you start playing. Right, now that was band signals, fates. We've done two more. Now these really just apply to churches. One is prayer. Should you pray before you play? You don't have to. If you've got a good working relationship with the Lord, then you're in a state of grace all the time. If you're constantly aware of His Holy Spirit, then it's maybe not terribly necessary, but if there's time, yeah, it won't do any harm. But don't leave your gear unattended while all five of you disappear into the vestry to have a play. Otherwise, you might, as I said earlier, you might come back and find that the bass guitar has been nicked. They're unlikely to nick the drum kit. It takes too long to take it to bits. In a praise band, should everyone be a Christian? I've been in situations where the boyfriend of the girl guitarist came along and took just a practice. Now he was a very good musician, a terribly nice chap. But while he was playing with us, it was just music. He went out for a cigarette at one point, and suddenly it was worship. So a non-believer in a praise band, yeah, it upsets things. On the other hand, you've got to, you know, again, it's this idea of bringing people into church. You want to encourage folk in. So if you've got this young lad and he's just still at the inquiry stage as regarding Christianity, and he asks if he can play along, I'd be inclined to give him a chance. If somebody's very shy, there was one girl came along who was extremely shy. So what we let her do was, look, said to her, you just sit in the front row, you're not plugged in, you've got an acoustic, you're not plugged in, and just get used to strumming along with us. 3 weeks later, she's up on the stage giving a loudy and singing hallelujahs to the Lord, you know. So he breaks people in gently to that situation. Now, second last thing. Some churches, they speak in tongues, which is an angelic language. It doesn't sound like English or German or Belgium. It's got its own syntax. It doesn't actually follow the rules of normal language. But it's one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit, if you want to look back in your Bible. Look to the book of Acts and chapter 2, I think you'll find the gift of tongues is given, maybe chapter 1, not sure. Well, it's still on the go, in spite of some theologians telling you that it's all been taken away, and that's just because they have it and they were jealous. But no, it's still, the gifts of the Holy Spirit are still alive and for you, if you're willing to receive them. But the gift of tongues, it also has a kind of cousin, which is singing in tongues. And this is something that charismatic churches will do at some point during the service. Now, it's not planned. It's not like, right, after the third song, we'll all sing in tongues. It doesn't work that way. It's a move of the Holy Spirit, and until the Holy Spirit hits the go button, it's just not going to happen. You know, you can't just turn it on. If you can't just turn it on, I would have my doubts about it. But here's what you do. Typically, it's going to come at the end of a slowish song. I've never come across it at the end of a fast number. But let's say you're in the key of D. And you end your song, and suddenly the congregation will start singing all different tunes, but all in the key of D. And it's a beautiful sound. It's absolutely gorgeous. It's not scripted. There are no words that you can learn. It's just, wow, this is the Holy Spirit moving. But as a musician, what do you do? Right, oh, we're singing, right. Well, you keep on the D. Go to A minor 7. Back to D. And see, it's really peaceful. And you just keep that going, those two chords, all the time. And eventually it will stop, and all the musicians and all the congregation will know when it is to stop. It never ends in chaos. It never peters out with you stopping and then stopping and then two people over there so being left in the other. No, it's ordered. It all stops together because we're all working for the same boss, basically. So that's this is not going to happen down your local pub, but and it may not happen down your local church either. It just depends on my local church. Nah, they wouldn't do that. Nah. But yes, I've been in places where that is the expected thing, and it will happen. You know, and it's lovely. Right, so the very last thing is very short, and it is this. Do not be a prat.